Good morning. Lovely, everyone. Seems like in some days, always rains getting stopped, and the sun is going to come back out. Everything is just going to explode. So it is raining. It is a fire watch in this building. So we can't have coffee inside. But we will hope that there are remaining rocks falling at that time. And my fellow, you can have a shake at my fellow. At any rate, welcome. Welcome in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Read that for millions of times. Probably in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we gather to worship. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, the Holy Trinity. God, welcoming you, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God, coming to you, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God, baptizing you, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And today, as we will hear, God always with you, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. That's an astonishing promise, really. Jesus promises that he is with you always. You may tire of him, but you'll never get rid of him. I'm with you always. Then he leaves you. Jesus only promises to be with you as he's out the door looking back over his shoulder, go ahead, I'll be around. God, leave me. Indeed, today, God's saying, go away, sending you away, out of your comfort zone, on your own, into the world, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God, calling us, get off the couch and go somewhere for Christ's sake. Every disciple before us, we only slowly recognize, maybe even reluctant. But this isn't about me. It's about discipleship. So in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we begin our worship, confession, and forgiveness. Will you please stand? Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who greets us in this and every season, whose word never fails, whose promise is sure.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned.
Thank you.
Keep us steadfast in this faith. Defend us in all adversity. And bring us at last into your presence, where you live in endless joy and love, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The first reading is from Genesis, chapter 1. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome. And it was so. God called the dome sky, and there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on earth that bear fruit with the seed in it." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with the seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the great light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky." So God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves of every kind, with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things, and wild animals of the earth of every kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and every thing that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." God said, "See, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. There was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. And on the seventh day, God finished the work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day, and from all the work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. Word of God, word of life. Please join me in the song. Join me for the bold print. O Lord, our Lord,
Amen.
any baptism is real. But like so many others have said, I think the gift of baptism had to be given to me as an infant. Before I made any decision about it, before the age of reason, I would have found no reason to go after it. God had to create faith in me. Because God knew I would be among the some that doubt. Because now, as an adult, I am all too aware of what it means to be baptized. It means, once baptized, that I am now a band of disciples charged to go, therefore, and make disciples of all people, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that Christ has commanded me to do. That's where we left it hanging last week. We baptized Matthew, and it was glorious. Like your baptism and every baptism ever after, it wasn't until he was sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever that he told him what he'd gotten himself into. There was that little bit about letting your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. And then we laid it out straight. We welcome you into the body of Christ and into the mission we share. Join us in giving thanks and praise to God and bearing God's creative and redeeming word to all the world. We made you a disciple, Matthew. We roped you into this mission we all share. And we did it in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. One God, the Holy Trinity, the name in which you live and move and have your being, the name of the one who created you, and the one who saves you, and the one who keeps you. One God, one Holy Trinity, who will not leave the world alone. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. That's what it says. And this is what I love about this story. Jesus rises from the dead and appears to his followers. They see him, they touch him, he talks to them and eats with them, he forgives them and blesses them, and forever after they become witnesses to the resurrection from the dead of Jesus Christ our Lord. But some doubt. And they're still there. Every single Easter story in the Bible has fear and confusion and doubt. It seems as if it's impossible to have faith in the resurrected Jesus without also having some doubts. But that it's okay. Believers worship Jesus and they have their doubts too. And one does not have to cancel out the other. Doubts are uncomfortable and nobody wants them. And of course, Jesus wants you to put doubt aside and have faith in him. Doubt? It's okay. Doubt is not a problem for Jesus. Jesus can work with doubt. In fact, God can create faith out of doubt. Indeed, God has to. It's not much of anything, doubt, but it is the only thing God has to work with. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. There was nothing in particular to be concerned about, nothing much to care about. The earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep. There was God, and that was about it. God in chaos. God like a wind sweeping over the face of an empty, watery, not much of it. God alone. It wasn't enough. It wasn't enough for God to be God alone. So God became something more by creating something more. God created the heavens and the earth. We're used to reading this story as if we were reading the newspaper, as if it was just a report of another week in the history of the world.
be a well-informed citizen, or we read it as if it were a science lesson, another theory of the way things are, an explanation of how things work, answers to know in case there's a pop quiz we didn't know about. Or maybe we read it as a way to do battle, with scientific answers that make us uncomfortable or seem too shallow to hold the wonder and the mystery of it all. I think to read the story that way is to miss the point altogether, maybe even to miss God altogether. It is something altogether different. It's a promise and a covenant. It's not a page out of history. It's not a science lesson. It's not biology. It is God creating a defining relationship with us. It is God telling us what it is like to have a God. It is God telling us that we are not God, that God is God and we are creatures. And that is the way it shall be with us in this relationship with God, in this relationship with one another and with all of God's creatures. It's not about biology of life, but the purpose of life. It proclaims that the Creator has a purpose and a will for creation. It's not about how we came to exist, it's about what we exist for. We exist for God and for one another, to respond to God's love, which is another way to talk about the obedience to God's will. And we exist for gladness, for the joy of being in relationship God and all God's creatures, which is another way to talk about worship. So God created that humankind in God's image. In the image of God, God created them male and female. God created them and blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. That's a lot of responsibility. That's a lot of relationship. And that's a gift, not a demand. It's not open for debate. God is God, you are not. That's the way it is with the sovereign God of the universe. But it is also God's passionate desire for you to share with God God's love and care of the earth. This story is inviting you into God's own purpose and reason for being, to make God's reason for being your reason for being. Theologian Walter Brueggemann once said that creation is God's decision not to look after himself, but to focus his energies and purposes on the creation. God decides not to be alone, but to be for you and for creation. God invites you not to be for yourself alone, but to be for God and for God's creation. God created you with a purpose, to be in relationship with God and to be in relationship with everything God has made. Just another way to say that we were created for worship. Because to do that is to truly worship God. Now the disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them, and when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. Not much to work with doubt. But it's okay. Doubt is not a problem for Jesus. Jesus can work with doubt. God can create faith out of doubt. How does God do that? When the disciples can't separate their faith and their worship from their doubts and their fears, what does Jesus do? Does he get mad? Does he lecture them? Come on, you guys, I'm counting on you. What more do you want? You can see me, you can feel me. So just stop. Believe in me or else. Believe in me right now. Just read the whole thing. Believe in me or I'll leave. No. He almost seems to ignore their doubts altogether. Matthew says that when the disciples doubted, Jesus didn't walk out of them. He came closer. He came near them. That's God's response to doubt. God who created you seeks you. God who created you for a relationship with God's self comes looking for you. You have your doubts. And God answers with promise, with the renewal of the promise to be your God. And the invitation, nay more, the call for you to be what God created you to be. To be in relationship with God and all of God's creation, to worship and to obey, to give up being for yourself alone and to be for God and to be for God's creation. They doubted. And Jesus came to them and said to them, All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. Jesus' answer to your doubts is to call you back to your God-given purpose. If creation is God's decision not to look after God's self, but to focus God's energies and purposes on the creation, then Jesus' answer is not to blame you for your doubts or your fears, but to call you to find your purpose in life, in worship, in obedience to Jesus' call to go out there and be for God and be for God's creation. Jesus does not debate with you about your doubts. He just embraces you doubts and all. When we are faithless, God remains faithful. He has committed himself to us, and God cannot deny God's self. God created you for a purpose, to be in relationship with God and all that God loves, and God will not give up calling you back to your purpose again and again. When you have doubts, rather give up and walk away, Christ pursues you. You are God coming at you, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God baptizing you, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God sending you away into the world, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God creating you with the purpose of never letting you go. And this is the promise of Christ for you. I will not let you go. I am with you always, to the end of the age. One God, the Holy Trinity, the name in which we live and move and have our being, the name of the one who created us, and the one who saves us, and the one who keeps us. One God, one Holy Trinity, will not leave the world alone.
Good to see you.
Excellent.
satisfy. You are the giver of all good things. Sustain us with these gifts of your creation, and multiply your graciousness in us, that the world may be fed with your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
presence and to receive forgiveness and love. Come with open minds and eager hands for the body and blood of life given for you.
Yeah.
and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen. Let us pray. We thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Send us now to spread your generosity into all the world through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The Holy Trinity, the one who created us, the one who redeemed us, the one who sustains us. About an hour ago, we gathered to worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, the Holy Trinity. God welcoming you, God baptizing you, God with you always, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Jesus with you always, you'll never get away. But then the end leaves you. Jesus only promises to be with you, and he's out the door, walking away over his shoulder, saying, okay, I'll be around. So today, like every day, we end with the sin. Go away from sin. Go back out there into the world. Seek not your comfort, but the comfort of others. The church, the disciples, the community that loves Jesus and loves each other, gathers to worship together, to support and encourage and comfort one another, only to find out that the purpose of the church is not the church. Your purpose in life, it's not you. It is discipleship, a call to love the world as God loves it. So go today in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, the God who calls across the cosmos and speaks in the smallest seed. Bless, keep, and sustain you now and to the end of the age.
Thank you.
was plugged in to this in Fort Knox, but when I started, it was like 30%, it was 36% of the time. So I don't know, I checked the recorder, it was plugged into the wall. So I don't know what the situation is.
Christian, great job.